The next talk will be about Parkour communications. And well, it's could be described as using the fixtures of the internet to communicate when everything else is blocked or broken or doesn't work. I'm very curious about the topic, and I hope you enjoy it. Wish you a good time, and let's give a warm welcome to Adrianus Warmenhoven. He's just a guy. Here you go.
Morning. I'm really happy that you even are here, because everybody's taken in their tents, and of course you had a couple of days which are really heavy. Who am I? My name is Adrianus Warmenhoven. You get my email address, and I work for a company called Red Sox, and yes, I wear red socks. That's what I always get asked. And I do research and development in analytics, and that is important. We get to that later, because I look at metadata on the network, and this is also why I came up with this topic. Let's first, of course, start with a disclaimer. I'm not a lawyer, so anything I say and anything you do, you may have to check in your country whether it's allowed or not. I think all of the things we're talking about are really normal usage of all the systems, so they should not be any problem. But sometimes there's some blanket statement in a law saying circumvent a certain blockade to visit specific websites, and then any method used, well, maybe get you into problems. Also, I may use a lot of he, but whenever I do that, of course, I mean everyone in the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, intersexual, asexual, pansexual, kink, and cis community. So I love you all, and I mean, he is just a way to describe something. And the last thing, of course, which is really important in my disclaimer, I'm trying to get a concept through to you, not specific full solutions, not something like an exploit, but rather a new way of thinking about how you can also use the internet. And, well, I thought, because of this last day, something really simple and nice and easy to do. You can do this literally with your granny in the old people's home, or you can do this with children at school. So, first thing is, why Parkour communications? Why even this subject? Well, one thing is, I want to do something different with hacking. I like, for me, hacking was always playing around with things and building new things and having fun with things. And, well, almost all the news I see about hackers nowadays is like these little Dr. Evils lurking about, and they all think, like, I want to have 300 bitcoins of you, something like that. You know, that's a bit bullshit. Also, the other thing about security, which we always see, is now I find a hole, somebody has done something stupid, they have misconfigured something, they haven't used software correctly or whatever, and instead of going to them and helping them fix it, I just go to the press or try to get as much karma as possible by just publishing it outside. That's one thing. Another reason is the knowledge and skill gap between security and productivity increases at the moment. So we have lots of developers building new applications, new stuff all the time. And the security personnel, the knowledge about that, well, it focuses on mostly diplomas and other really specific stuff. Not enough hackers, this is really a pet peeve of mine, are really involved in education in schools. Yeah, we get some soldering and some playing around with robots, but what I really want is more education in what is the internet, how does it work, and how can we play with it, and how can we use it. And this is also the lack of easy and fun things to do with non-technical people. As I said earlier, this is what I'm going to propose, the Parkour communication, is something you can do with your literally can do with your grandmother in the old people's home, or with your children at home, or with your friends who are non-technical. You can figure things out and have fun with it. And of course, almost all hackers nowadays, well, they download Kali Linux, they know how to use Metasploit, they know the offensive security CVE database, and they're all the same hackers, you know? Nobody tries to do something new or play around or have fun with it. So this is, for me, is quite an important part. Parkour communications is, well, just something I thought up and trying to have some new fun with the internet. So I mentioned the name parkour communications. Well, basically, what is parkour actually? Well, parkour is these guys you sometimes see which do amazing feats in the city. They run around in the city and they use the city. They use everything that is there. They don't build new tracks. They don't build new things to climb on. They just go from A to B in a way they want to do and just use everything that's there. They don't need anything new. They don't need to break anything either. They just use whatever is there. So, just as in the same, in the away from keyboard parkour, there's a lot of fixtures that make the internet work. And with fixtures, I mean things like lighting, beams like this, traffic lights, street lights. Those are all things, and like the plumbing, that was what makes the internet work. Like for the internet, it's like name servers, it's web servers, it's mail servers, search engines. And slowly we also get things like all the things that Facebook provides or whatever. And mind you, I'm not talking about anything fighting against the NSA here or like the deep web or something like that, just about fun things of communication. And I know that a lot of things I'm going to talk about are not really secure in the hardest sense of the word, but just bear with me. As I said earlier, there's no need to break in all these systems, to just own them or modify them. Traceurs, which are the people that run through the city, well, as I said, they do not rebuild or modify parts of the city. And we can use all those items just as they are intended. We can use, I will show later on, we can use the search engines just as they are intended. We can use the email just as it is intended for our own purposes. So, first, about metadata. I need to give you some context. My job is working with metadata. I can really see what kind of web page you visit, even if you have an encrypted web page, even if you have a really good encrypted connection. And I can see that because of the size of the web page, but also on what other domains you are calling, because nowadays you have a lot of JavaScript libraries. We have CDNs, which call in different libraries. There's a lot of extra activity that your browser does, which gives to me an indication on what you are actually doing. And I don't need even need to see the content. Actually, I work with metadata, which is called IPFix, which is kind of like NetFlow. I don't know if anybody knows that, but this is just router information about how many packets, what size the packets are, and what timing it is. Only from that, I can quite confidently deduce what you are doing on the network. And content monitoring. Well, content monitoring, that's actually when you have the contents. This is why when people start snooping non-secured communications. To get a good idea about the metadata, it's an old one, but if you go there, Don't put in your email, because they ask that you can put in your email. This is an old MIT project. They'll show you lots of intentions that you have and a lot of activities just by who are you contacting, who are you emailing with, and from whom are you getting emails with. This is the same if you are on things like LinkedIn, but also on Facebook, if you are more active with certain people. Well, at that point, you can infer intent. And it goes even so far that you can say, well, you're going to have a dinner date with this guy at probably next week or something like that. Or you're going to change your job. And you have all heard the stories about Facebook being able to predict when you're going to break up. Well, Facebook also uses a lot of content. So without the specific content, that's a lot harder. But really, all the metadata, and this is actually what most of the agencies use, I can tell you about that. All this metadata is actually what gives us a picture about what everybody is doing. We don't really need to have the content of that, and we don't really need to see what you are saying from A to B. We just need to see who is connected to whom and who's talking to whom. So this whole metadata thing, that's the first thing we actually have to defeat if you want to do, well, some specific communications and some hidden communications. And this is what I want to do with Parkour communication. I'll talk to you about that. So again, the content monitoring, the end-to-end encryption, well, it makes things harder to crack. Not impossible, because there's lots of, and you've been on the Congress here, so you know about this. There's been lots of progress on decrypting lots of various encryption algorithms. There's man in the middle things, there's root certificate attacks. It just makes it harder. But again, I can tell you that most of the agencies don't need to do that to keep a track of what the populace is doing. Well, what we're doing with Parkour communications is we're not going from A to B. I'm going to give somebody else my communication and really hope that in some way it comes to the intended person. One of the things I did in physically, which is not in this presentation, but maybe on the next presentation, is do something like a Chinese whispers with a school. You can have lots of small same messages and give them to people and just hope that at some point, like a peer-to-peer system, they arrive at the intended person. And maybe at the next Congress, I'm going to do a competition on physical offline communication. That would be fun. And of course, if you're going to do the things we're going to talk about, important text, you really should encrypt and Base64 encode them. But it makes it easier to spot. If I'm doing content monitoring, like any of the agencies, I can see, I can make something called engrams, or I can do letter counting, letter frequencies, and I can see if it's a Base64 encoded message or not, or even if it's an encrypted message or not, without looking at the content directly. I can just count all the bytes and say, okay, this is an encrypted message, or this is a Base64 encoded message, or this is normal text. So, let's start with some fun things. The first thing about Parkour communications is we're going to use all the different items on the internet. I'm going to give you a couple of examples. And I really hope that at the end, you can come up with some extra examples or your own examples. So let's start with the first one. Well, this is the easiest one, which will always work. You go to any of the search engines, and your buddy has registered some domain .tld, top-level domain. And then you say, okay, search engine, you have to archive or crawl some domain .tld, and then your message. Okay. The search engine says, well, okay, I'm going to do that. So at some point, and this is where the metadata analysis breaks down, where you have defeated metadata analysis, I will show you that in a minute. At some point, the web server, the search engine, gets scrolling that specific URL. And then in the log file of your friend, well, he will see a 404, which is this page does not exist. This has two effects. Your friend now has the message, but the web crawler, it says, ah, I don't see it, so it doesn't index that message. So it will not appear anywhere. And you have successfully sent the message to your friend without directly contacting him. In metadata, if I look from a metadata point of view, from an agency or from myself, it looks like this. You connect to the search engine. At some point later on, the search engine connects to the web server of your buddy. At some point later on, totally disjunct from each other, your buddy connects to that web server. And because there's so many of these things going on at the same time, the correlation with just metadata is completely lost for any agency. It's really hard, unless they already suspect that you might be in communication. They could do something about it, but most of the time, your connection to the search engine is encrypted anyway. You might be just searching the web pages or doing something else there. So for this specific method, what are the ingredients for just this way of communicating? Well, you just need any largest, and large is because otherwise the metadata again points to you. You need search engines which are in the top 100 because they have lots of traffic, and then your specific traffic will be lost. Like Google, Bing, Yahoo, Baidu, Ask, well, you see them. Archive.org, you have to be a bit careful because sometimes they also archive 404 pages, and then your message will get archived as well. Well, the other side, your buddy needs to have his own web server. And the web server doesn't have to do anything. It only needs to have a log file when a crawler comes along to store the 404 message in. And the fun part is most of the hosting companies nowadays, even if you're not technical, you can just buy a server, it gets installed, and you have a control panel where you can see the log files. And it's all point and click. There's nothing to do as a technical person. So again, this method, you could do that with your granny. Same thing with the CMS, and you have a visitors plugin, which shows you when a web server comes along and which URLs it has crawled. So these two items together easily defeat at the moment. I'm not saying that this will happen. It will still be true in a year or 2 years. They will easily defeat a correlation of communication between you and me. And we have done nothing illegal. We have not set up a VPN, even if that's illegal in some cities. If Twitter is down, we have done or blocked, we can still communicate with each other. We can still send messages to each other, and we're not abusing anything. Well, there's also other methods, because if you only use one method, of course, after a while, well, the agencies might wise up, and then suddenly they think, yeah, okay, everybody's using a search engine, now we're going to do something with the search engine, or all the ISPs are provided to give all the logs, or something like that. So let's figure out the second way. This is just, again, examples. I really, really, really want everybody to come up later on, or when they're at home or something, with different methods. Just use the internet. Because if you use it, you're not doing something out of the ordinary, and this exactly is what all the agencies are looking for, anomaly detection. But if you, I can tell you from experience that if you stay within a norm, then even neural networks and machine learning will not be able to find you. And this is what I'm trying to convey here, is, well, try to use the internet for your own purposes, and then you will not be flagged by all these systems. Well, the other one is, just go order a pizza or go to a complaint form. Well, the order pizza really worked. I had really fun with a friend of mine. Well, the problem also is you get a really full belly, but you just order pizza online with these delivery services. And almost all of these delivery services have a little form where you can say something to the pizzeria or eatery where you order. And they will also send the whole of it as an email as a confirmation. So what you do, you go and you order your own fun pizza, and in that little message box, you write whatever message you want. The only problem is, of course, the guys at the pizzeria will also read that message, and if it's really weird, then okay. And you put your friends, your contacts, email address in that box. Well, at some point, that message simply gets delivered to your friend and you get a pizza. Again, there's no correlation for any of the agencies between you and your contact to find out. So, from metadata view, it looks a bit like this. You are going to the web server of the pizzeria. Well, that happens. That web server sends something to the mail server. And if you do it on the correct time spot, like when it's really busy, it will get in batches, and so there's nothing out of the ordinary happening. And at some point, your buddy checks his email and sees a confirmation message from the pizzeria with your message in it. So from a metadata standpoint, there's no correlation between you and your contact. And again, we have done nothing out of the ordinary. There's no abuse. We have nothing developed or broken. We have not stepped over any laws. So what do you need for this? Well, a vendor that has an email confirmation for purchases. Don't use the account option, because then the account will always be sent in the email. That's not a good idea. The complaint forms, that's also a nice one. I've tried that one as well. With every complaint you make with a lot of vendors, you get a confirmation back again, and you can do the same trick. You write a really nice message for your friend, and put your friend's email address in there, and then the confirmation of the complaint gets sent to them. Only problem is, of course, that if you make the message too weird, the company getting the complaint will follow up and try to figure out what's going on. And if they think something shady is going on, they might register it. So, and this is my third example, and basically this is the last example, and later on I'll try to see if you can figure out something some as well. There's these anti-spam providers, and 33 mail or email, if you want, is one of them. And if you register with them, you get your personal subdomain, let's say adrianus at 33mail.com. And you can have any prefix in front of that. And now the fun part is that you can send a message using the email contact. So what I'm doing is I'm sending a message to my contact, and my real message is in the ad address, not in the content. In the content, I can put some really innocent stuff in there. So if there's any content filter, it will just be flagged like, okay, it's normal stuff, no problem at all. Because at the moment, none of these systems will check all these email addresses, because they're throwaway email addresses. And throwaway email addresses are by nature a lot of random junk, a lot of random names. You use them once for one site, and then you throw them away. But if you're clever, you can just use that instead of random junk, you can just send a message using that email address. So again, for metadata view, I sent an email to 33mail. At some point, that system will send it to your buddy's email address, and he will fetch his email. There's no direct correlation between my email provider and the other. So, what do we need? Well, this is a bit more complicated, but not too hard. You can still get your granny to use this. A Base64 encoder decoder for the message, or if you really don't care, you can just put your message in plain text as well. And you need an email relayer. Well, one of these will do. There's many. Just look for disposable emails. I will get there. But basically, that's another way of just using systems as they are intended to, and not getting any correlation. So, I'm going really way too fast now. Okay. What else can we do? Well, I've tried a couple of other things. I've tried advertisements. The fun thing with advertisements, and now we're going getting a bit more technical, so you have to skip this with your granny. You can do this with a couple of friends who are a bit more technical, but not there's nothing too involved in here. For instance, shopping carts and advertisements, cookies and log files. Well, a lot of cookies for advertisements are protected, that they are not that they shouldn't be stolen by other people, like request forgeries and all those things. But there's nothing protecting those cookies if I take it and give it to you or to you. And what happens then is really fun. You probably have seen this effect sometimes, that if in your house you start looking for a new laptop, then suddenly all your all the people living in the same house also get advertisements for that new laptop, or for a car, or something else. And that's just if you don't use an ad blocker, or if you just buy IP. But the fun part is, if you take all these cookies, all these hard-coded cookies, and just share them together, you can have a really worldwide spanning communication network. Because then I can say, well, we use the first letter of each item that comes into in the advertisements, and then we really slowly encode and decode. And this is almost impossible for any agency to track. And also it gives you the real satisfaction that you're using the advertisement networks, like these indestructible bulletproof networks, for your own use. So again, what you do is, I take my advertisement cookies, I just put them on a USB stick, give them to all my friends, and whenever I look at something, they all get the same result. And whenever they look at something, they all get the same result. Another one which you can do is shopping carts. Well, we can give shopping cart cookies to each other and just use the wish lists and all those kind of things on Amazon or whatever, and have whole conversations in those wish lists. Again, on metadata level, this is almost impossible to figure out what is going on, because there's no direct correlation in our communications here. Well, and this was actually something I wanted to have prepared a bit more for the SHA, but yeah, then life happened. What if they switch off the internet? Well, we had a couple of tests already, and this is really fun. If you have take toilet roll papers, toilet rolls, and you paint a couple of them black and a couple of them white, they leave them white. You can stack them just like a QR code, and the distance at which they are still really readable is quite large. And we did some fun tests where one person at one end had a stack of toilet roll in a QR code. You read it, you stack your own, and then the person further on reads it. And what I wanted to do actually was make some bandwidth testing. I didn't come to that, and some speed testing. But this is just one idea which you can use. Also, if you just print out a QR code and hang it in your window, if you live in a large flat, then people can really quickly communicate and send digital data across without using the internet at all. Well, you also have barcode readers. Well, if people stand in the correct sequence, we also tested that with a picture. That didn't work so well. You can do it as a barcode, but at not none of these items we ever changed or abused the things that they were being meant to do. So, oh yeah, and also of course the really old one, SneakerNet, is just giving each other USB sticks. I'm really way too fast. I'm sorry about that. So let's do some questions. Thank you for listening on this day. So if you have any questions also about the metadata and what I can see, because maybe I skipped that part too much, or whatever you want.
Yeah, thank you for your nice and refreshing talk. It was a good way of looking differently at the thing you already use. My question is this. Your premises is that you want to communicate between two persons that do not physically have contact with each other, so they're away from each other. That is the idea. I can send a communication from one to one without, you know, you can go to a park and talk, but that is, yeah. Of course, yeah. How is this, for example, this seems like a modern way of, you know, publishing cryptographic advertisements in the newspaper, like we used to do before.
Yes.
And then the internet came, and the first thing that appeared for a communication without being seen was this technique called steganography.
Right.
And actually, this technique is so good that I think that is also very difficult for ages to see, because you can put messages in the noise of pictures. Or you really have to look very hard to find that, and I don't think they will see that in the metadata. So yes, this is fun, and this is. But is it also effective?
No, I wouldn't use it as your main method if you're an activist. I really wanted this to get more people into thinking about it, about the internet in this way, as just like the traceurs in Parkour. They see a city and they see it as a new whole playground. They don't need to wreck the city to use it as their playground.
Yeah, okay,
and I want
clear.
People to see the internet the same way.
Yeah.
Just as we as hackers did in the early days, it's your playground, play with it. By the way, about the steganography, I can say something about that in metadata as well. If for some reason the intensity and rhythm of your image uploads changes, I can detect that. And so if you use steganography or any of the cryptographic methods, you have to be extremely careful in things like timing, in things like intensity, and in things like volume, for me not to kind of detect what is going on. Because if I look at your communications, if I want to infer what your communications, I'm not only looking at what you're doing, but also what is happening to you and to the people around you. So if you suddenly start uploading a lot of images, and I figured out that at somewhere there's a subpoena against you, then I can pretty much put one and one to two together and say, okay, you're communicating with people about this the subject of this subpoena. I may not know the content, but really be careful about that. And one thing why I'm just giving examples, and I really want people to figure out things for themselves or figure out new ways, is because of this diversity. This is just like normal economics. No company or agency will invest a lot in a possible way of communicating. If we all would use the same methods I just showed, then of course it's economically feasible for any agency or company to make a detection for that. But if everybody figures out in their own way different methods, then it's really hard to figure out. Then I really first have to tag somebody, and well, this is what we all want for lawful interception. You really want to have a case first, not dragnet monitoring.
Yes, may I comment shortly on that? Of course, I understand this, but I think that also applies for pizzas, because I never ate pizzas,
yeah.
And then I start ordering pizzas, yeah, yeah. And then what's happening in this house?
Correct.
So, I mean, this, you have to also be aware how his opponent thinks before you do something.
Yes.
And for example, if I want to use something message in a picture, I would not do it myself. I could have picked it to my daughter, put it on Facebook, because she's putting a lot on Facebook, so that's not going to be noticed.
Yes,
yes? Something like this. Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
I really like to talk, but I have a question. Did you try layering these things? Like, I can put a GET request in Google for archive.org, which requests something else, so you have it layered.
But I think it's awesome. Yeah. You should really try that.
And you could also maybe put a QR code that is a Google link to a search, and just put it somewhere, and someone else will deliver the message for you.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. That's awesome. Anyone else? It's the last day, so. Okay, then thank you. And, one thing, please have a round of applause for all the angels and the heralds and everybody who made this conference.